everybody. This is the September 19th Committee on Community Resources meeting. We are a standing committee of the City Council. It's a little bit different than what the Gazette said today, but that's what we are. And I am going to call this meeting to order now, and when Pam returns, ask her to please take the role.
Councilor Bidwell?
Here.
Councilor Carney?
Present.
Councilor Klein?
Here.
Councilor Scherer?
Here. So our first order of business is, as we always start, with public comment. The rule of conduct that we follow for public comment here in committee is the same as we do for the full council. We request civility and respect for all participants. Though you may say what you like about us as public figures, and we do not respond during public comment, we ask that you do not say anything that constitutes defamation about anyone other than us. And when you come to the podium, please state your name and address for the record, and please try and limit your comment to about 3 minutes. We didn't have a sign-up sheet today, but anyone would anyone like to come and speak at public comment? For the last four meetings we've had were public forums in which people came and spoke. That's not what this meeting is today. This is a regular committee meeting in which we are going to discuss the committee study request that we've just done all of our data collection for. But so there's not going to be another time to interact with us. So if there is something that you want to talk to us about, this would now be the time.
Can we not talk later in the meeting? I mean, it's either now.
That's correct. No, this is your time to talk to us. It's not a public forum today or a hearing. It's a meeting that you're certainly welcome to be here for, but this would be the time to address us if you'd like to. Please.
It's really simple. I'm Nancy Cowan from Happy Valley. I just want to say thank you so much. This has been a tremendous commitment that you've made to the time and effort it takes to try to work through all these issues. Thank you so much for doing this.
Anybody else like to come and up and talk to us for public comment? No? Okay.
Is this something that goes on the record, or can I?
Yes, yeah. This is an open public session. Everything you say is on the record.
Okay.
Including
I'm
asking.
I'm just learning. That's why I don't want to go all public with my thoughts and concerns.
I'm sorry, what
I
did
might
you?
Not understand the issues. Do you know what I mean?
I missed the first thing that you said.
I said I hesitate to go public with my thoughts and concerns because I'm really pretty new to the issue, so I don't like to stick my foot in my mouth.
Come on, give it a shot.
Come, if you're going to talk to us, I'm afraid you have to come to the podium and state your name and address. We are an open public body, and that's the way it is.
Okay, that's right. I'm Peter Sutterdahl. I live in Amherst, and I own two buildings in Northampton. I've raised my children in the area, so I spent a lot of time in Northampton with the children as they were growing up. And the panhandling issue is now a particular concern to me as a landlord because my tenants, businesses, may or may not be affected by panhandling. And it's been my observation that many of the panhandlers appear to be either drug addicted or mentally ill. That's a blanket statement, not true for all, but I think it's kind of safe to say that a good number of them fall into those categories. So I think by supporting the panhandlers, by giving them money, which is an impulse I think that many of us have, we're really supporting the continuation of their drug addiction or alcohol addiction. And so it seems to me that maybe possibly an education campaign. I read one of the letters to the editor in the Gazette was suggesting putting like boxes all up and down the street where people can give money to the boxes to support the local charities that support people with drug addiction. But if by giving it directly to many of the panhandlers who are drug addicted, it really just perpetuates the problem. And so I don't know if what you said when you were walking in or earlier that you're looking for creative ideas to try to address the problem. And the one that I read in the Gazette seemed like a reasonably good idea. I'm done. 3 minutes.
Appreciate it. You did great. Anybody else like to comment? No? Okay. Then we are going to move into the rest of our agenda. Can I have a motion on the minutes for July 18th?
Second.
Has been made and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
No objections? No abstentions? Okay. Okay, so now for the rest of our agenda, we are going to talk about all that we heard during the committee study request. And, you know, I'm sorry to disappoint all the media that's here that seems to be under the impression that we're going to discuss panhandling today. We're not, any more than we're going to discuss any of the other, 25, 30 other topics, more than that. It's not a specific item on the agenda for today. It is, I'm not sure where people got that misconception or why they put it out there, but that's not what we're talking about today. You're welcome to stay, but if that's what you're hoping to hear is a discussion on it, it's not gonna happen. So moving into this, what we're going to talk about is this great compilation tally summary that Jonathan Goldman did for us with the help of Councilor Bidwell. Thank you, Councilor Bidwell. That he went through all the minutes and maybe even the videos and kind of pulled out the sort of larger themes and topics, and then did subtopics underneath them, and then did a tally of how many people spoke to that issue. And so what I would like to do is to go through, you know, category by category, and then the sub categories, and talk about what we want to pursue further. I asked you all to hopefully take a look at this and come with some ideas on what you think are things that just clearly aren't things that we can pursue. They're just not something that's under our jurisdiction. I think there's some of these here that are pretty obvious that we are just not something we can work on. And then things that you think that we could delve into further with the thought that at the end of all this, perhaps we're going to have some recommendations or thoughts for the full council. So, unless anyone has an objection, should we just start and go through? Did everyone have a chance to look?
Yeah, please. Let me just say one other thing. When Jonathan and I sat down to think about doing this, we recognized that He did some of the minutes, I did some of the minutes, and we, you know, both recognized this is not getting scientific. We don't pretend that it's a rigorous quantitative analysis. But we did want to just get a flavor of what themes tended to emerge time after time after time, and to tally them to just give us some sense. But I think As I went back and looked over it for me, and I'm not sure where you hope we'll wind up at the end of our meeting today, but I think they do fall into either categories where we just say it's not appropriate for us to get involved, period, or maybe it is something that we want to tackle and see if it's worthy of an ordinance or a resolution. Or in other cases, we would really recommend that other parties, whether it's the mayor and his administration, or whether it's social service agencies or arts agencies, et cetera, we would really encourage action there, and perhaps we could stimulate some coming together of folks. And then I do think there are some issues that more fall into the category of putting facts on the table and correcting misinformation could perhaps be handled through an op-ed piece, one or more, just put views and facts out there. So my own sense is I would like to see us make some progress in figuring out into which those categories and other categories some of these issues fall. So that's just my point.
I think I agree. First of all, this is really helpful. This chart is great to be able to just see them in relation to each other, these concerns, and they're so thanks for working on this, Councilor. And I think clearly some are higher numerically than others. I don't know how you wanted to just go through category by category.
Yeah, I think we should go category by category. I mean, I think, yes, some of them are higher, but I don't know that that necessarily means that they're of more importance or that there's something that we can more take action on. So maybe we should just start at the top and go down. Okay. So the first category is arts capital dollars not enough. And this was sort of our last public forum is where we heard about, where we invited sort of arts and organization stakeholders to come and talk, and this is where we heard this. And sort of the more tangible recommendation that we heard was that there's interest that the CPA be broadened to include being able to have funds go to art facilities and organizations. Obviously, that's not something that we could do on our own, but is something that we could support or talk about more. Thoughts? I thought it was an interesting idea.
I mean, I think that they brought up the actual objection that they would expect to meet from, you know, the already small pool of resources going to historic and conservation and what will happen.
And recreation now, which was added. And yeah, sort of went through that process of having other groups feel. Yeah.
But it is an interesting way to kind of raise some support.
Well, like you said, clearly this is outside of our jurisdiction in terms of shifting how the CPA is managed. That has to happen at the State House level. But I feel like one of the things that we didn't get enough input around, that I feel like I have some knowledge from last term's social services, veterans, culture, and arts. I'm not sure I got that exactly right. Committee. Just that there are a number of very vibrant arts organizations in our community that feel like they do want to figure out how to foster more interaction with the city and with municipal government and to get what they feel like would be more support. And so, I mean, we could go with this one recommendation of Richard Wagner, who is the president of the Arts Trust, to kind of make a recommendation. We could write a letter of support, we could write an op-ed, something like that, about shifting the CPA if we felt it was necessary. But I guess I'd like to think a little bit more broadly about how the city council can play a role in really fostering more of a connection with arts organizations and really promoting the arts. I think we have a lot of, to use a this term loosely, a lot of kind of negative feedback from the forums, a lot of problems that were identified. But I think that this is one that we can approach with a lot of positivity and a lot of just see it as a way to enrich our community more broadly. So I would love for us to figure out what role the city council can play in strengthening the arts in Northampton and working as more of a partner with arts organizations that are nonprofit organizations in the city.
When we somewhat arbitrarily divided comments into categories, most of the comments about arts-related activity and where, and specific recommendations fell into this events, festivals, promotion category. Mm-hmm. And there were a lot of quite specific and interesting suggestions there. And so I think when we get to that, it would be a good time to kick around that. With regard to the CPA, I think I would be one of those that would not be too enthusiastic about encouraging the legislature to further dilute that pool of dollars going further. I think the way it's working is great and sympathetic as I mentioned, needing to find ways to invest more capital in arts facilities. That's not one I would be supportive of.
Well, why don't we skip to the events, festivals, and promotion just because, and kind of make it more of an all-encompassing discussion of this idea, because I feel like if we're going to spend more time, we will probably be including many of these things, and I guess just to pause for a second. I didn't really talk about this, but moving forward, sort of how I envision this is going to go is that we're pulling out a few different, we're going to whittle down this list to things that we really feel like we can spend more time on and do more of our due diligence on, maybe learn more about, and so over the next few months as we meet, what I would like is that we get this list down so that we, each meeting, we will, I assume, have other business that we have to do for the committee, but that we talk about one or two. And so in that month between the meetings, we look at what we're going to discuss next more in depth on our own and then come to the meeting ready to kind of really delve into that. Does that sound reasonable to you guys? Okay. So let's go on to, let's skip to the events, festivals, promotion. And talk about, let's go through these quickly and then see whether we want to just say, yes, this is something that we feel we can work on and then we will assign this to a future meeting to talk about more, okay? Mm-hmm. So recommendations that people gave at the forums were more promotion of arts walks, year-round permanent downtown market, more travel website visibility, an artist market around the holiday season, it looks like, more festivals or events, spread events around more downtown. Keep up, that should say bag day, not bad day, bag day. Sidewalk sales. There's thoughts about Pulaski Park and whether there could be more of a band shell there, maybe in phase two of the reconstruction of Pulaski Park. More venues for arts and pop-up art in vacant retail. Anyone have any comments on that? No?
Yes. I'm not quite sure where we...
Right.
How to dive in. I have a feeling that between Center for the Arts, the rec department folks who are doing programming of Pulaski Park, the Arts Council, the Arts Trust.
DNA.
That there's already people talking about all these things probably way out in front of us.
Mm-hmm.
And one possibility would be to see if there would be any interest in convening a meeting of those organizations to both inform us of the progress being made in a variety of these areas, no doubt, but also to foster, because I sometimes hear that there could be more coordination among such organizations, to see if we could get most of those groups in the room at the same time and run through four or five different areas that we've heard talked about, and see if coming out of that there might be a little clearer path on some of these, or in many cases discover that, well, of course, that's where, don't you know, we're already planning on doing this, and this.
Right. Maybe it makes sense for us, just in terms of processing this, to come up with our own sort of categories, how we're going to label these things. So whether it's like support or legislation, does that sort of make sense? Like if we kind of put, and so I feel like many of these things are not, they're not things that we could actually pass something for, but we could offer support and we could encourage the people involved to, and have them feel like we're more invested. Sorry, go ahead.
I think before that step of classifying kind of what our actions could be, and what Councillor Bidwell, you're talking about, is having some kind of interim step, which is, we have a little bit of expertise in this, using the arts as an example, in this realm, but probably not nearly as much as the people that in our city who are actively engaged every day with this topic. And so I like the idea of convening folks, but I think the most important thing we need to think about is just asking very concretely. I mean, we have to be careful about how we're spending our time. This could,
yeah.
I mean, that could turn into a project that could be every meeting for the rest of this term, you know, talking about what we could do to support the arts. But I think that we have to ask for some very concrete guidance from the stakeholders, you know, the people working the arts in the city right now, and say, you know, what are the things you would want from us? And then we can kind of do that culling process of figuring out what we can do and we can't do with them and for them. So whether it be convening them to kind of, you know, we could hand pick the leaders of each of the arts organizations, Brian Foote from the Arts Council. I mean, we could come up with a list and we could convene people and do it in that fashion, or we could send out maybe some kind of letter or very brief survey asking them, you know, what are your top priorities? What do you envision the city council being able to do to support you? They may not know what we can and can't do, what our limitations are, but if we can hear from them some concrete ideas of what kind of support they would want from us, we can then kind of pull those apart, I would think.
Just a better perspective, I mean, this used to be a city council subcommittee dedicated exclusively to the arts. City council subcommittee on the arts, and so this fills a void by doing some of this work, certainly, and even folks who are still out there doing that will, you know, would probably appreciate the extent to which we can offer support if that's the, you know, if we do break those things down in that category. But I agree that breaking them down into support or legislate or is a good idea. This seems more like a support category.
I mean, I have my eye towards the completion of this process, because it's we were tasked with a giant thing to look at and have invested a lot of time already, and I would like this to culminate in something. So we've already produced a report, which just really was a summary of how we collected data. And at the end, when we're done deliberating through these topics, I would like us to produce something else that that maybe keeps these general themes, but says, you know, on this topic, you know, we discussed it. We would like to be, we feel like the council could be more supportive. In the future, as a committee, we would like to work with these arts organizations and see how we can interact more. Sorry about that. Does that sound reasonable?
Mm-hmm.
Because I think we sort of have a few different things that we're trying to do here. We are trying to still complete this request that's been given to us. But also think about how, you know, the whole point of this is to see how we, these committees and this one in particular, can be more engaged. Okay. So, it sounds like this is the topic that we are interested in, but don't necessarily know specific steps for next, right? Like if we were to spend half a meeting on this, what would that look like? Right, that's what I'm trying to, that's what we're trying to do is figure out how we're gonna divide our time coming up. So maybe this is the topic where we say, we heard these 12 suggestions. We think that they have merit. We'd like to sort of pursue them further, or we'd like to find a way to work with arts organizations so that we can support them in pursuing them. Does that sound reasonable?
I think where we started out was made a lot of sense for us to go down the list before we kind of, you know, make final decisions about any one of these things. I think we should kind of go through it.
So we're going to go through this twice.
About each one.
See what rises.
Yeah, I think it'll help us see what kind of rises as well.
Okay. All right, so we covered two. Moving on to the next one, Amazon online sales impacts. People were generally concerned across multiple meetings. And I think we all share their concern. I know I share their concern. Anyone else have thoughts on this?
I think this is probably one of those that falls in the category of it's a real issue, and we all need to be aware that it's a real issue, but practically speaking, there are areas where we can make a more direct impact than anything we do with it.
Anyone else agree with that?
Unless, if I could just add one, unless in a, if we were decided to do one or more op-ed pieces, we can just reinforce the shop local message. The, you know, there's plenty of other folks putting that message out there, but it never hurts to say it again.
I mean, I think we do have resolutions about shop local already on the books, but it's, you know, I mean, it's something that to consider for things that the city does business with, for any vendors or events or anything like that. I mean, just to be, you know, cognizant of the to what extent we as a city are losing local merchants and not relying on online retailers. We could, I mean, that's one way we can just kind of I don't know, there really isn't a mechanism for this, but we could be reminded of our original shop local resolution and maybe even add on language about having, to the extent that the city can be a leader in that, ensuring that our, you know, our purchasing practices are local, to the extent possible.
Mm-hmm. I appreciate that. I think it's a great suggestion. I'm also thinking about the other things here that are commerce related, and one of the things I could imagine our committee being able to do is figure out how to make a series of recommendations to the mayor and to the city's office of what is it called, Terry Masterson's
economic development
and working with the Chamber of Commerce, or just making suggestions about working with the Chamber of Commerce, to figure out, I mean, we have good information here about how commerce might be suffering in our city. And so to possibly write up a series of recommendations of how the offices, city departments can work to promote, you know, shopping local, how to kind of maybe frame some of the messaging that we heard, or counter messaging to kind of counter the problematic things like shopping online. So there may just be some way that we can do something that is not, you know, getting out there and standing with signs on the corner of streets, but at least making recommendations about how we as a city, how the mayor's staff can be working to promote local commerce. And that may be, again, kind of like we talked about with bringing in arts organizations to have a discussion with them. It may be we want to do a more focused session with the chamber and see, you know, if they have concrete suggestions about how we can be supporting the messaging. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, I'm a little bit all over the place there.
Well, actually, Ms. Cowan was here but left, unfortunately. She talked about the idea, you know, what she sort of wants to bring to her own business, that, you know, she recognizes that online sales are a universal issue everywhere right now, but, and forevermore, I would imagine. But so she is it sort of reimagining her business as more of like an experience, a place for experience, and which I thought was a very interesting idea. I'm not sure how we would promote that, but I don't see it reflected on this chart, so I just wanted to remind all of us that she said that.
That seems to be linked up with the events piece too, because that's one of the things she did talk about, right, is, you know, creating kinds of events, right, with the DNA and the chamber and all the local owners, yeah, to create that kind of, do create what they call creative placemaking around the commerce in the city.
Casino impact worries. Also mentioned a few times across multiple meetings. Anyone have any thoughts on that? Again, something I think a worry we share. But I also think kind of goes back to what we were just talking about. How do we make the experience in Northampton something that people will come for, even when other things are vying for their attention? Okay. City government attitude towards business. Multiple sub concerns that the city is generally not supportive enough, that the council sided with labor at the Hotel Northampton, that I guess this says transparent city government uses tax dollars well.
They weren't all complaints. There's some positive comments.
Somewhat.
Oh yes, I remember the.
One person thinks that we use tax dollars well. Thank you. Praise for praise for our continual voting for a single tax rate. Someone said we were not supportive of the arts and that the city is ambiguous about enforcement.
I think that was related to Tesla's concern.
Right. About code enforcement.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, anyone have any thoughts about people's attitudes about our attitudes?
I'd like to think that this process and the outcomes of this process will counter some of this perception. If we really come up with a set of recommendations and we actually tackle particular areas, I think they all will be speaking to something related to these issues here.
I would agree.
Yeah. So just by virtue of this process, we are hopefully working on showing that we actually are trying to be supportive of this house. I would agree. Anyone else? Okay, cost of doing business downtown. Increasing wage / benefit costs, paid sick leave cost, too high rent, cost of sidewalk signs for second floor businesses, and larger increases for small business health insurance.
Well, one thing that I think helped having Terry Masterson, I think it was Terry's presentation, they clarified the rents, at least in terms of relative to those other surrounding towns, as being really within the ballpark. That there definitely is a perception that the rents are really high in Northampton, but I think that, you know, he was able to show that relatively they were not the exorbitant rates that people might think they are. Not to say that they're not too high for some people, but I think it was all relative to cities and town, other cities and towns that are in the ballpark.
Because he's here, can I recognize him to ask a question? I'm referring to our economic development director, Terry Masterson.
Yes. Let's recognize Terry.
When you and the mayor put out an update back in August, updated your economic indicators, very nice little report. Do you feel that that's gotten enough attention? Has it done something to counter negativity, whether it's city revenues with, you know, tax revenues are just flat or rents are too high? Have these facts gotten out there adequately to counter some of those opinions in your view?
I think, you know, say yes. And I think that the statistics that came out in the middle of the year sort of re-changed the interpretation of the ones that came out at the beginning of the year. The beginning of the year showed there were a lot of empty storefronts, and there was a concern that that wasn't a good sign. But the mid-year report showed that many of the storefronts that were empty in January were still empty in the summer, but in the meantime, 20 other retail transactions went on in the downtown that filled spots that either were never empty for a couple of days, or some that had been empty for a while or a longer period of time. So I think if it's changed, you know, I think at the end of the year when the next round of indicators come out, it'll be interesting to see what that shows as well. To the extent that it's making changes, up to see. You know, but to the question of where are retail rents, a store owner can go onto the website and look where retail rents are compared to Hartford or New Haven or Stamford or White Plains, and hopefully that helps them understand whether the rent they're paying here is proportionate or fair. Clearly the rents here are at that level or those levels, and that says something about the climate that's here. Obviously people have said, well, don't even bother to compare Northampton to Chicopee or Holyoke or Springfield. There's simply no comparison because the gap is so wide. So the next step is to say, okay, how do we stack up against Hartford or Haven, which are major retail markets? I mean, the Break King property on Pleasant Street, which is next to the Northampton Lumber Yard, the asking rent on the website is $23 a foot at 2,000 square feet. That's almost $45,000 to $50,000 a year that you would pay in rent for 2,000 square feet of a gas station. That's a lot of money. I mean, that's a considerable amount, I think, to, you have to really have a good budget to see that that revenue you can equal that, you can equal revenue to equal that expense. Is that answering the question? I don't want to ramble on.
Yeah, I guess I'm also kind of wondering what we can do to better get out some of this information, and maybe this comes back to this op-ed piece that we keep talking about.
Well, I think it's continually on the website, and it just, as I said, as the months will go by, it'll get more robust. I don't know that any town or city has that much data right now on the website, so I think that's a step forward too. I think there'll be a greater conversation in the coming year about what impact, if any, the casino will have, and I think that that's going to force a lot of stakeholders to try to talk to each other, to try to say, is this something we should be worried about? Is this something we can prepare for? Is this something that we can find other areas of downtown growth to offset what might be a negative impact from the casino? Or some people have started to tell me there may not be that much impact. But to me, whatever comes out of that conversation, the benefit is it's going to put a lot of people together, because building owners are going to have to talk to store owners to have that conversation about whether this is going to be an issue or not. And I'm hopeful that out of that, some positives come from that as well.
Okay, so I feel like these are sort of things that fall under the category of, you know, we can indicate support, but there's not a lot, you know, we are not in charge of paid sick leave. These are things that are not under our jurisdiction.
The cost of sidewalk signs for second floor businesses,
right.
Maybe that's something.
I think that is the one thing under this list that we could have an actual impact on. So should we mark that to talk about further?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
One thing that is not on this list of subheadings that I heard, maybe it's built into one of these, was the issue that was expressed by a few people about how particular landlords are holding out for rents that are quite a bit higher than other, kind of the median rent in the city, and that's driving rents upward more broadly. I don't know if we have that theory of some of the speakers disproven, and that might be something that we can ask you again, Terry. But I'm just wondering if that's something, a lot of people said, is there some way that you can impose some kind of incentive to landlords to, do you remember people saying things like that, to actually rent out their properties and not just keep them empty, you know, waiting for very high rents? And it's my understanding that we don't have a lot of leeway there. There's not a lot that we can do, but I'm wondering just about that theory that we heard from a bunch of people. Is that in fact an issue? Is that situation driving rents up?
Mm-hmm. Maybe that's under vacant retail spaces. I see need city incentives to those who keep space rented.
Yeah, I think that is the,
okay.
That is the issue.
Okay.
Do you want to jump to that?
Let's jump to that. So that's under vacant retail spaces, third page. So general concerns. Then some people said sort of what Terry was just saying, or what we've been saying, that, you know, beyond sort of one property owner that has kept places empty, that actually we're seeing fairly normal vacancy rates, cycles. People talking about the Calvin A remaining unfixed, which there's been some movement on that this past week. Though it's still missing, I believe. And recommendations of an ordinance requiring, what is rent up for vacancy?
We heard that suggestion, and we all sat here nodding, knowing that it's not anything we can do.
So an incentive to get people to rent vacant.
It was an observation. Yes.
city incentives to keep space rented or to rent space. So, I mean, is this something that we feel like we should look into further to see if there actually is something we can do, or to sort of explore those ideas that were thrown out there?
Well, I'd like to have more of a sense of whether it's really an issue, if it does have the effect of artificially raising rents, which is what people were saying. And if that is the case, then I would like to see if there's something that a city council can affect to create some kind of an incentivizing group.
My own view, having heard the same thing everyone else heard and talked to folks, is that that's just not the case. I mean, we do have an example of one major property owner who operates on a business model that none of the rest of us can quite understand. Other property owners, for the most part, have recognized that no matter what they think should be, they'd like to have a rent. They would rather rent out their buildings if that means adjusting the rent appropriately. And so I think that's what produces a downtown that has a number of vacancies attributable to one property owner and other vacancies rotating on a more or less more common sort of cycle. So everything I've heard has debunked that notion. Plus, it has I don't know what there is in our ability or authority to do anything about it in any event. So my own preference would be to find some way of putting that message out there. The kind of what I just said that we don't think that, with the exception of, with one glaring exception, that rents are glaringly out of line, nor are vacancy rates glaringly out of line, and that to the extent we have some high rents, we're sort of a victim of our own success as a community that people like to do business in, and that we should, there's a lot of things we can do, but that's one where we just need to let the market work its way through over time.
Other thoughts? And you know, if there are some things that we feel like we want to do more research on, we can certainly take some time to do that. But okay, let's keep moving. So going back to our list. Downtown condo owners not supported enough. Someone talked about ugly entrances to upper floor residences, and that they're too expensive, which are both things that I don't believe we have any control over, nor should we. But the thing that was mentioned that we do is that there needs to be more code enforcement, whether it was dumpsters or I think that was the main thing we heard, is that there was not.
And also conformity. I think there was an issue about that is code enforcement, but uniformity enforcement.
Mm-hmm. We did actually raise that question. Councilor Bidwell asked the building commissioner at the city services meeting, if you can remember what he said. He said something about...
Well, he was acutely aware of a couple of examples that we heard and seems on top of them and responsive. And I don't know whether we know enough about these situations to think that they're relatively isolated situations and not representative of a larger problem. I think that would probably be mm-hmm. building commissioners.
Right. Okay. Moving on, Downtown Northampton Association. there were some general supportive comments about it. Someone felt that the city needed to be more supportive. I think at that point we pointed out what the city's involvement with it, which the person who made that comment wasn't aware of. There were a few people who liked an idea put forward that we should use liquor license revenue for the lighting program, the DNA, and that more downtown events should be planned, I guess, by the DNA. So obviously we are not the DNA. We could pass on those recommendations, although I think that the executive director was here and heard them. And in terms of the liquor license revenue, I'm not sure that that's possible. We also might want to sort of come up with a list of things that we would eventually, like, I don't want to sort of piecemeal ask city departments, but if we had a list of things that we'd like to ask, whether it's the city solicitor or it's Mr. Masterson or another department, we should come up with a list of those sorts of things, and I would think that would
help. I think we should keep in sort of a running list of questions that we refer to the mayor and ask if he and his department heads could get back to us at some point.
Can we ask you, Pam, to highlight those things? And we can put a list together for the mayor to share with his department.
Okay, so the next topic we already covered. We're moving on to food trucks / carts. Someone thinks we need food carts in Posky Park, and someone else thought we needed to experiment with limited food trucks. This is obviously a topic that's been brought up a lot lately. I feel like this is one of these things that, you know, it might be, I know there are reasons why we limit food trucks down in the center, you know, downtown. We could look into the history of that and see what we think in terms of a recommendation going forward.
There was also a comment, I think it was just one, but I think it's very related to this one, which is about pop-up food events in retail spaces or empty retail spaces, so I think that would kind of fit in there.
Mm-hmm. And not a part of anything that we heard here, but separate from that, I've heard suggestions that if we wanted to just do an experiment with food trucks, if there were a food truck out by the hospital, out by Cooley Dick, where it's not directly competing with either downtown Florence or downtown Northampton restaurants, or down along Pleasant Street, perhaps as part of the revisioning of Pleasant Street, that there might be a few places around town where we can experiment.
I have to look at the ordinance, but that may already be legal. I mean, you can have food trucks down.
Hot dog truck that you get on.
Right, and then there was one that was in Florence for a while, the park in Florence. So I think that the ordinance is specific to downtown, and that elsewhere there actually are, they are allowed.
I thought there was some additional regulation even outside. Okay.
It might not be either every day. It might be like, you know, certain days. Mm-hmm. But I know that it's much stricter in the center of town. Maybe we want to look at that further.
Yeah.
Shall we?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We can add that to our list for the mayor, right? Just to ask about pertinent. Actually, it's our ordinance.
We can look up the ordinance. Okay. Negativity about that the negativity about downtown is harmful. General concerns about that. Someone thinks that the improvements to the academy are great. Couldn't agree more. Businesses very generously support many nonprofits. Also true. CISA Local Hero Program's excellent. These are all positive. Which is funny, because the category is negativity about downtown's harmful. Inaccurate info / rumors about vacancies and rents. People seeing all restaurants as bad.
Oh, I think that was, we had several folks in the context of worker issues and wage theft issues expressing concern that not here, but to a certain extent, there's something that the way the media was portraying that discussion was that it was kind of treating all sweeping, you know, painting all restaurants with the same bad brush, if you will.
Okay.
I think is what was meant there. Yes, many of these shorthand comments certainly don't capture the richness of the conversation.
Right. And as we kind of go through and pull out for more in-depth conversation, I would recommend that people go, you know, the members of the committee go through and look at the minutes again and even maybe watch the video to really get through the depth of what people were expressing to us. And then the recommendation under this is need to celebrate major public and private investments. Can you talk to me more about that?
It may be that some of the data that we've heard from Terry Masterson and the mayor, just summaries of what in fact have been substantial investments by the city, oftentimes with state dollars behind it, and private investment. It is substantial, and I would agree with those comments that we need to draw more attention to.
Need to toot all the positive horns more.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
All right. So, I mean, again, this is sort of a perception category, which I think we hope this work is working to fix or alleviate or change that perception. Does anyone have any thoughts about this category? No, sort of more point of conversation. Okay. Next one is panhandling. General concerns about it, concerns that it turns off prospective tenants, that it turns away shoppers, that the police department is too permissive about it, and concerns, kind of like what we heard, well, no, we didn't hear this concern, but concerns that some panhandlers aren't in fact homeless. And then the recommendations that people made were that we require permits for solicitation, we encourage donation to agencies/services, which is something else we heard today, that we pass an ordinance regulating where and when, and that we have more outreach workers, and that this idea that's been employed in Albuquerque that you employ panhandlers as day laborers. Anyone want to speak to this?
This was a topic that Jonathan Goldman did a little further research on. He looked at, and this is along the lines of what we heard from Peter Satterdahl.
Yeah.
More or less, I have that right. There are a couple of cities that have repurposed their no longer used parking meters to become little collection boxes, if you will, around town, with the funds going to pantries, social service agencies, et cetera. And Jonathan looked at examples of those programs in Pasadena and in Denver and in Orlando, and was particularly impressed with the way it was working in Denver, and encouraged further look at that. And then there was this, as you indicated, a program in Albuquerque that it looked at where some city employee basically had some walking around money to hire people on the spot to, instead of panhandling, do work that wasn't being gotten to by other city employees. And then he found some program, I'm not sure where it was, but where they experimented with providing licenses to street musicians, but putting them in particular places, and where licensed street musicians in places that were attracting panhandling sort of moved panhandling on. So So there were a number of things that he looked at in a very cursory way that that might be worthy of a little further thought, or might be. This would be one of those areas where I suspect if we convened a group of four or five people, we would discover that all these ideas have been thought of and looked at. And, but I do think because we heard so much commentary on this topic, including here today, that we should at the very least encourage some group of social service agencies. Is convening regularly to consider some of these other possibilities.
Okay, so should we agree that this will be a topic that we will cover more in depth? Maybe looking at these ideas. I mean, so, you know, some of these ideas I think we talked about during the forums, and sort of back and forth with people recommending them. You know, some have been thought about before, some have been tried before, some have been tried other places and struck down in the courts. You know, there are certain things that just violate First Amendment, and that's the way it is. But you know, I think we're always open to new creative ideas, and I'd be happy to sort of talk as a group about what we've heard.
Well, Peg Keller was here, and I'm assuming she may have been here. Her homeless advocate for homeless and other folks with housing. And to the extent that may overlap with Canhandle. But we could always have a conversation with her. I think she's here. I'm not sure, though. She may be here for the police. But she would probably be a good resource for us to talk this through with.
Right. And certainly, you know, since people do often want to talk about an ordinance, we might want to put this on the list of something to talk about with the city solicitor, who could just clarify for us once again sort of where the law is on it.
Yes.
I think this is something that the city council has been approached about for years, and there is stuff that's been done way before my time. Maybe Maureen, you were here for some of it, I think. So I don't want us to kind of recreate the wheel. So I'd like us to, if we are going to explore this, really have a good sense of what has been attempted and what the pitfalls were. They're both legal pitfalls and they're, I think, social issues. I know that in the past, when the city council was thinking about regulating panhandling in some way, there was just pretty mass outcry and public marches and all kinds of stuff that really kind of shut down the process. And I think, in fact, the Vibrant Sidewalks resolution came out of that, which was an attempt to affirm, you know, that everyone and anyone could be in on our downtown sidewalks and doing whatever they're doing. So I want us to be careful that we're not revisiting exactly the same ground in the same way without having the history clear. And I'd just like to say, I mean, I'm going to have to figure out how to navigate this one, because I feel very strongly that I would not want to regulate in any way panhandling. It's a very deep value of mine. So we'll have to figure that out as a committee when we start talking about it at a kind of deeper level. But I feel that that's important for me to state.
Okay, moving on, parking, something we've just heard a whole lot about. So general concerns, there's the people who own Union Station have issues with their lot, so they've come here and talked about it multiple times. That enforcement is too aggressive. That parking time should be extended, that credit card payment should be a possibility, that we'll need ticket machines. What does that mean?
I guess
people don't
I
like
was,
the ticket machines?
I think that was maybe replacing ticket machines with online.
Okay.
Online reserving a parking place, but apps.
Angled parking and encourage businesses to validate for garage. So the good news is, a lot of these we can just check off. So.
We did try rear end angle parking. Does everybody remember that experiment?
It was that one.
Yes.
Stranger, we really took it for that.
Yeah.
No, it didn't go over well.
But in fairness, the way it's been described to me, we don't need to get too diverted on this, was that if you're ever going to really start, you need to do a much bigger area. If you just do one isolated area and try it, it's going to be a disaster.
Confuse people.
But in any event, we'll let others worry about that.
I think it's a little bit irrelevant too, because we're now, as a city, looking at kind of redesigning the downtown streets and creating a bike lane between the sidewalk and the parking spaces. So I think all of that is in process and is going to be shifted and changed.
Right.
Exactly. And the first recommendations from the parking study are just coming forward now, which including extending parking times. I have heard that we are going to get credit card payment. We are going to get payment by app. It's just not happening until probably after the first of the year, because that's when the machines would come in. So before that, there's a hope that for the holiday season, we would be have the parking time extended on Main Street. No one asked for the parking rate to go up, I see, but that's also happening. Or is that recommended? No one came to us asking for that. And so I think, you know, and I think we should encourage businesses to validate for the grant, or to use the validation tickets that we already exist. Apparently Tespo at Beehive is the only business who has taken advantage of that program. So other businesses should. She is the only one, really? The mayor said, yes.
That's a chamber and DNA promotion.
There you go. So I think parking, while something people want to talk to us about, I think is in process and not necessarily something.
Can I just make another recommendation too, that anything that it does feel needs to be discussed in this category would actually be more within the purview of the Transportation and Parking Commission than this group. So we might want to, and we have the vice chair right here, kind of wholesale, just hand this over to your commission to talk about and see if any of these aren't being addressed with all the changes that are afoot.
Right.
I like that idea.
Yeah? I'm glad you guys like that idea. Well, are there any things here that you think, I mean, I feel like the only thing that's on here that isn't already being addressed is angled parking, which, as we talked about, there is some thought of a larger redesign, or encouraging businesses to validate, which I think is not really a Transportation and Parking Commission issue. If anything else comes up, feel free to tell me about it. And the union station issue is I think.
Some progress being made.
I think there's some progress being made, but also not necessarily something specific for us to get involved in. And then enforcement is too aggressive is, I would say, a perennial complaint, and the person who gets a ticket was always just almost right there in time.
Well, this wasn't one of the issues that we heard at the forums, but we did hear this at the public comment the other night about,
that's true.
And it raised the question of whether or not there should be
like a loading,
some allowance for loading and unloading. And that could be something we could consider in terms of an ordinance.
That's supportive of the downtown business, too, to have a typical business.
Well, in this case here, the business has said that, you know, routinely they have been told people could vote.
I'm going to quickly fill in Councilor Bidwell, who was not at that meeting.
Oh, yeah.
Someone came to public comment and said that she had bought a keyboard at Birdhouse Music, mm-hmm. and the owner had said, just pull around and stop out front because it's a heavy keyboard and I'll come help you load it into your car. And so she pulled around and she went in to get him, and in that those like few seconds of her going in
with her flashers on
she got a ticket. And so Birdhouse had had, you know, said that this is a concern for them, they've had other problems, but they've also talked to the city, and the city said, yeah, sure, don't worry about that, but you got a ticket. And so, yeah, so maybe that is something that we want to talk about more. How can we accommodate kind of quick?
One of the things that have brought up for me that I think is actually more the purview of the Transportation and Parking Commission than this committee is what the appeals process is and who, in fact, and again, this is because it's a city staff issue, it would have to go to the mayor's office, but who constitutes the appeals committee? And that is something that I would like to ask the mayor about and maybe have the Transportation and Parking Commission follow up on. Because it was my understanding, I kind of looked into it a little bit afterwards, that there are two people on that, you know, committee. It's not quite a committee, it's two staff members. And I think that it kind of, hearing that particular story and thinking about how we can support downtown business and getting their business done and things like loading, I think we could look into that a little bit more as just even the appeals process and how it happens.
So I'm going to recommend that these two issues we sort of reserve to talk about maybe a little bit more, and that sort of in our recommendations, that maybe that would be something that we recommend go, you know, be reviewed by Transportation Parking. Okay. Mm-hmm. Smith College. One person said they give more than any other entity, and one person said they need to give more.
This is the big one. That's really funny. I don't think we have any interest if we can offer that issue. I mean, I think the key is supporting the payment in lieu of taxes, and that's pretty much what we can do at this juncture.
Right. I would agree with that. We just finished Smith College. Any other thoughts? No. Startup costs of small businesses. General concerns about them, that lending is difficult to get, which was an interesting thing to hear about that I hadn't heard, you know, I wasn't familiar with. Someone had the idea that the city needs to have a grant program for startups. I guess there's a program in Dallas that does that.
I think we have resources locally that, you know, maybe didn't exist in Dallas, and so the city actually took on starting a grant program. But through UMass, we have this small business, I forget the exact name, do you folks know what I'm talking about, that does consulting and helps small businesses, small startups and small businesses to get loans. And so I think that's a resource that exists, just not operated by the city. I don't know if, you know, we could play a role in helping small businesses or startups to access that resource, but I don't think it's a resource that we as a city would be able to create.
Right. And doesn't Valley CDC also do that sort of work?
Yes, yes.
So they teach classes on, or they hold classes on it. There's also now Valley Venture Mentors out of Springfield. So I think that there are some, but maybe we could promote that more, I don't know. The lending, I don't see what we can do about that.
Yeah, I mean, we are fortunate to have a lot of resources for consulting and networking. But that's different than that first loan for a startup business, which is tough to come by and has been getting tougher to come by. Not that we can do anything about it, but it was helpful for us to understand that that can be a significant impediment.
So more to talk about on this, or?
I mean, if we think about the work that we're doing here, as a possibility for the work that we're doing here is writing up a series of recommendations. One of the things we might want to consider for this one is talking to the DNA and the chamber, I mean, I imagine they promote those resources that we just named, but that they have more of a kind of hand in promoting those resources and getting the information out there publicly.
Okay, so recommendation to promote existing resources. Okay, any other thoughts on that? Okay, tourism. One comment that we need more money to promote tourism.
Did that come from the chamber? Was that Suzanne Beck that said that?
I'm pretty sure that was somebody else. She certainly was talking about how the chamber uses the tourism. Yes, it is always an issue that the legislature keeps cutting back. I mean, that too could be one of these other, another category of issues that need to be pursued in the legislature if we want to tackle them. Not suggesting this be one of them, but some of them do fall in that category.
Right.
I'm wondering again if this, kind of in the realm of recommendations, we could talk about having the Economic Development Office of the city play a particular role. I mean, I know that it already does. Terry's not here anymore, is he? But just wondering if there's some way we can, again, you know, in the spirit of our trying to be creative around this, we can encourage more proactive tourist promotion coming out of that office. We're working with the DNA and again the chamber to work together to figure out how to do that.
Any other thoughts? Okay, transportation. Need more Amtrak service, need more commuter rail. More of it needed. With the recommendation of wider accessibility. Yes.
Accessibility meaning what?
Maybe more of it needed.
It might have just been another way of saying more times through scattered through the day. Mm-hmm. Although it's not reflected here, I remember there was talk about. More frequently scheduled PVTA service for the benefit, particularly the workers. It seems to have escaped. That's what that was related to. Mm-hmm.
I was just wondering if the accessibility was referring to disability access, but
I don't think it was.
So. What I'm remembering is more worker access to downtown public transportation. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so thoughts about this? I mean, I know that we already, I believe the city already does try very much to lobby for more of all of this kind of service. So we could certainly try to be more supportive of that effort.
I know the mayor sits on the PVTA advisory body, and I'm wondering if there's ever been a council member on that advisory body as well as the mayor, and if that's something that we might want to think about, seeing if somebody would be interested in being a liaison from the council to that body. And then the other question I have here is about the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission, because I know that they have served a role in encouraging Amtrak service and all of that, so I'm wondering if there's some kind of conversation that can be had there.
There have been very extensive conversations, I know, and there's a group that convenes with some regularity that Terry Masterson knows all about. So this could be one of those brief updates that would be helpful to us.
Okay, so ask for an update from Terry on this?
Well, I would think they would all go to the mayor.
Okay.
And the mayor would presumably have asked Terry to give us an update.
Okay. But in terms of what we could actually do, other than if there was someone who sat on the committee, I'm not sure what we can do other than be supportive of the idea that yes, more of it is needed, as was stated before in our ways.
Again, this might be something more for the Transportation and Parking Commission.
You love that, don't you?
Especially since I'm not on it.
I do like that idea.
But it really is logical, don't you think?
It is.
There is some logic to it. It does involve transportation, yes. Okay, well, then maybe we will recommend that that commission was setting up. Next topic, vacant retail space. Okay, we already did that one. Is this the last?
Well, you'll notice these are in alphabetical order.
Yes, these are in alphabetical order.
So placement here meant nothing more than that.
It is the last. It's just for coverage. So worker issues / concerns. General concerns, fear of retaliation by managers, poor worker treatment, not being paid minimum wage, not being paid overtime, concern about undocumented workers being hired, and then recommendations that we heard were a resolution or an ordinance against wage theft, oversight boards, doing away with tips throughout the city, and better enforcement. I would assume that means better enforcement of payment of wages or of fair treatment.
Existing
workers.
Wage laws, I guess.
I know I want to speak to this topic. This is something that we heard about a lot. We had many, many, many comments. There was a very organized effort to come and talk to us on worker issues. So at almost every meeting, I think we heard about these issues.
Well, the notion of a wage theft legislation was kind of circulating around long before this committee got its charge and started doing its work. And some of the stuff that we looked at the very beginning of the committee, sample legislations from the different towns, and then of course we had the results of the UMass Labor Studies and Worker Center report. What was I saying? So a lot of work had actually been started in motion around that, not only here, but you know, as we heard from Boston and Cambridge, and I guess just last week in Worcester. Worcester just passed a new wage theft ordinance. But what I found when I was looking through most of these materials and trying to come up with you know, some possible legislation was that it fell into three areas. There was the possibility of linking licenses to compliance with wage and hour law, with procurement language that dealt with trying to link city contracts with also demonstrating compliance with wage and hour law, and with building permits or even other things that got raised in some of our public comment here by the Carpenters Union, possible tying of certificates of occupancy with showing that you've complied with laws. And a lot of those things just raise some really big questions, which is why this has kind of been stalled for so long. What I've noticed is every city town has its own, you know, way of looking at it. So for example, in Worcester just last week, they kept their anti-wage theft ordinance focused entirely on city contracts, whereas some of the other towns had city contracts and licenses. And what I've been told from some folks who helped in the drafting of legislation is trying to tie building permits at all really raises an issue of home rule. So there's really just been a lot of complication around that, but I still think that we can probably address many of the concerns that were raised at the public forum, certainly by looking at some legislation tying licenses, which are already tied right now with demonstrating, an applicant must demonstrate that they have paid in full and out with their taxes, that they're carrying a workers' comp policy. And this would be one additional form, you know, that would say, yes, we are paying, we are complying with all Massachusetts wage and hour laws, or no, we have a finding against us, but we can post a wage bond. That's the way they've done that in most of the cities and towns. So they, that's what the license would be tied to. So I guess, you know, we're at a point where we're probably focusing primarily on that piece. And that was really the majority of the folks that we heard from were from kind of the restaurant industry to deal with some of the issues raised by folks from the construction industry and carpentry. That may be a conversation with the mayor's office. It may be trying to figure some way, as Pam had pointed out to me as we were looking through these things. We don't deal with procurement at all in our ordinances. Our procurement is strictly governed by a 60-page set of guidelines out of the procurement office, which is under the city auditor, so which is under the mayor's jurisdiction. So that may be a conversation, you know, at some point, then bringing in the mayor and saying, would the mayor consider the guidelines which are in the process of being revised to take in some regulation, but may the mayor also consider including language in the procurement guidelines that really requires people that we do business with, contractors, vendors, that they demonstrate that they're in compliance with wage and hour law. And again, most of those things can be done by virtue of filling out a form. Follow-up can happen if there's good reason for follow-up from the staff to the license commission, or from, you know, the procurement office, if we were to get language like that into the procurement guidelines. But those are the areas, that's kind of where we're at. We're still kind of in the finalizing some sort of drafts, and Councilor Klein and I probably are hoping to have some sort of conversations with the mayor's office in the next few weeks if we can arrange that. But so the timing is, I don't know whether something would then come back to this committee, you know, whether we want to talk about this as a committee, just use the opportunity to look at the material that we did receive and consider. I mean, it would be important to, I think, take in whatever feedback folks, other committee members have from the forums. And, okay.
Long story short.
No.
At my understanding is there is something being worked on right now. And I would assume that it would come to this, that it would make sense that it would get referred to this committee. It obviously will get referred to legislative matters, but I would think it would be referred to this committee because
if only
economic.
Because we did all of the research with the.
Well, also, it's sort of, you know.
Logical place anyway.
Right, it kind of falls under our purview. So I guess, you know, sort of in the interest of not like doing double work or not sort of stepping on work that's being done, I would say if whatever's being worked on presently, I would like to wait for it to come to this committee. And then certainly we can use the resources that, you know, we heard a great deal and we have a lot of information that would inform our thoughts on it. But other ideas, like if procurement is not an aspect of what's being worked on presently, it certainly could be something that we could talk about as a recommendation for the mayor.
Mm-hmm.
I remain curious about the actual implementation and enforcement but rather than have that be hypothetical, and just wait until I actually see something.
Right. Does that good? But that doesn't necessarily encompass, I feel like what we're talking about directly there is a wage, let's like call it what it is. We're talking about like a wage theft ordinance or resolution that's in the works. Versus, and then the idea that there might be something additional or something else in terms of procurement that could be a recommendation in as part of this work. But that doesn't necessarily encompass all of the things that we heard from workers. So, although certainly some of them. So I'm not, I don't think we should just like not address, you know, this general topic at all, because I think there are plenty of other things that we've heard. The question is, you know, what sort of impact we could have. I don't know, but anyone have any thoughts on that?
Just looking at the other sub-issues, like issues of minimum wage, overtime, some of those are built into a wage theft ordinance, but I think that there is advocacy that we potentially could do at the State House, should we choose to do that, around wages. I think we would have to familiarize ourselves with what is, I mean, really know what's happening at the State House in terms of those kinds of pieces of legislation. It might be writing resolutions in support of them, or writing a letter from the council to relevant legislators. So that might be something that we have to look into a little bit deeper and see what's kind of brewing at that level.
Well, we know that there is the state legislation that the Senate passed this term, and it didn't get taken up by the House. Peter Kokin is one of the co-sponsors. And I mean, I think that if that would not, you know, that would be something that would be, that we could look at in terms of just saying support of the state, the legislation before the state. And that would be probably in the form of a resolution. That's a possibility.
Generally, is this the legislation that would provide more enforcement dollars to the Attorney General's office, among other things?
Yeah, and broadens the scope of the Attorney General's powers. So, for example, if they could actually do work stoppage, where right now they can only do that if it's a workers' comp issue or something, they can't stop the job, but they would be able to actually issue stop work orders for non-payment of wages.
Okay, so it sounds like there's more discussion we could have about the general topic. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, I was wondering if maybe we're not at this stage yet, but that might be a place where we could already do a little bit of homework and gather and share amongst committee members the legislation and look at where we could maybe go with writing a supportive resolution or letter. Yeah, if we want to assign that as a duty to somebody.
Well, I mean, so we've reached the end of this list. So the next thing to do is to sort of figure. I feel like there are some things, but not many, that we just said absolutely are not for further discussion. So I think we need to figure out how we want to divide these or group these things, whether just keep them alphabetical or if there's more of a sort of logical way to do it, to spend, you know, a more in-depth amount of time. So whether it's at our next meeting, you know, we take two or three of these things, we come with some preparation, having looked at, you know, reviewed what we heard, looked at any data that we received, and have a more specific conversation about them. And I guess we will make it, you know, it may take us a few meetings to make it through these. So it doesn't seem like we're wrapping up this process anytime too soon. And apparently I've got a lot of work in transportation.
It seems to be growing.
Yeah. Okay. So from the top, these, let's say, first, what are the first three we want to start working on?
Can I?
Please,
offer a,
help me.
Well, I've just been keeping my own little tally of four or five questions that we wanted to refer to the mayor.
Okay.
So we have that as a starting point. And then I sense others don't share my enthusiasm for this idea, but I think that a number of these issues could be tackled in some kind of working meeting with arts organizations. And some could be tackled by referring them to the group of social service organizations already dealing with communities. And some could be discussed if we were to have Chamber and Dean meet with us. Kind of in working, more working group fashion. I don't know if just the way we operate as a committee lends itself to working group like that.
But, right.
But I would find that productive.
I love the idea of working groups because I think it's a collaborative process and that's wonderful. And I think we're actually meeting with the people who have the expertise in the realms that we're talking about. However, I also see, I would see a need for us to be very directive in what our questions are and what we're trying to get at, because otherwise I feel like we're gonna end up doing more forums, public forums in a sense, I mean, with the experts, but I think that we're just gathering more data. So I feel like before we get to that point, I would like us as a committee to kind of really home in on what the questions are, what we want to achieve, and then pull them in for their expertise about how we might do that. And so we'd be able to have a very structured conversation.
I totally agree. If we were to move in that direction, I would imagine us agreeing on the agenda, the questions submitted in advance, and invite people to come in and discuss specific questions. I agree. There's no point in more open-ended all over the place. We've done that.
I mean, I feel like I would even take that one step further and say that if we wanted to have sort of a working group, that might be a recommendation. Like, that falls under a recommendation category. Like, we recommend that a working group be formed to work, to look at this further.
To be formed by whom?
Well,
what's the difference between recommending the formation of a working group and just trying to convene it ourselves?
Because I want to wrap up this study. I worry this could go on forever, you know. And so if this is something that we think needs more outside group work, that's not necessarily something, a bus that we should drive.
I think there can be a difference between wrapping up the study and going to a deeper place with particular issues that were identified in the study. So I don't think that those have to be mutually exclusive processes. I think we can wrap up the study, but with the outcome of the study, then have kind of marching orders for this.
Right, maybe it's a recommendation to ourselves.
Yeah.
That we, we think we need to work more on this.
I'm afraid I really have to go. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
All right. So how would we like to handle this, everybody? I wanted us to have a nice, clear, organized set of meetings going forward.
I hate to say it, but I'm wondering if there's a way we can condense the chart or kind of pull out the salient pieces from the chart and with the notes that we have thanks to our wonderful administrative assistant, recreate the chart into what our working areas are.
Okay. How about that? Pam and I are going to work on that, and I am going to make some category. I'm going to sort of assign topics for the next few meetings after condensing the chart with Pam, and I will distribute it to everyone, and that's what we will be discussing at the next few meetings. Does that sound reasonable? Yes?
Leaving open the possibility of, on some of those topics, inviting other folks to join us.
But not as part of the study, I think we just said, as kind of, as the outcome of the study? Or do you see that as part of the ongoing?
Well, for example, the arts organizations, and I know you've got to go. I could see describing it as one 90-minute, you know, one 60-minute conversation. These are the four topics. And at the end of that, we're done. We've gathered more information. We may have, at that point, be in a position to make a recommendation or two. And one of those recommendations would probably be that this group continue to work as a working group on these issues without us being there. I don't see any of this going on open-ended, but I do see some possibilities for in a few of these areas where there are issues and recommendations that have clustered to just have one finite meeting with experts who really know this stuff, with some specific questions in advance, and with no intention that we stay in the business of being part of that working group, but just be a one-time, and then maybe it would go somewhere independent of us.
I'd like to suggest that since we would have to meet again to come up with those questions, that we table kind of the rest of the process to the next meeting. Because if you guys aren't ready to adjourn, I do have to leave. I don't want to, you know, like put a kibosh on what you're saying right
now. No, because we've all got.
We have more discussion that we have to have to prepare for that meeting anyway.
We do, and I would be glad to work with the chair in coming up with a draft of the questions that we might submit to two or three different groups of folks around these areas so that we can discuss those at our next meeting, if there's any interest in doing it at all.
Okay, bye.
Sorry.
That's okay. I guess I will think about this further, but I would say right now what I, in terms of bringing more people in to confer with us, I would lean towards using those resources for clarification on law, like with the city solicitor. And things like that, as opposed to sort of creating more, I feel like that creates more data. And it doesn't mean that it's not something we can't do, but I feel like that would be something that part of, in the conclusion of the study in our report, we would say, we heard these different things and we're interested in working together with some arts organizations to address these four questions. And that is something we'll be working on in the future.
I'd rather have that final report say that we have convened one meeting with these folks, got the ball rolling, they now have it on their own.
Okay. Councilor Carney, do you have any thoughts?
I don't feel strongly one way or the other about that.
Okay. Then should Councilor Bidwell and I get together and talk about what those questions are and see if we can come to a conclusion on how to handle that?
Mm-hmm.
That's Okay. All right. Is there anything else we want to talk about in terms of this chart and what we discussed today and going forward? I feel like we're more stalled than I'd like us to be, but I'm trying to come to terms with it.
Do we want to submit these four or five questions that have come up to the mayor?
I don't think so yet.
Okay.
Because again, I don't want to sort of do it piecemeal. I'd rather we have sort of more of a concise list of things to ask and work on. Okay. Then we have no new business. I have no new business. Anyone else have new business? Items referred to the committee are is after adjourned.
I tried to pull that off the agenda.
Okay. There's nothing referred to us right now.
After adjourning.
Okay. So that was a motion.
Then I would make my motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay, thank you.